I don't know about you, but there's probably something. There's been something in my week I'd like to forget. there's probably been something in your year you'd like to forget or to put behind you, right?
Amen.
And the beautiful thing is that, you know, you have a whole year ahead of you, and you don't have to let what happened last year dictate what happens next year.
Amen.
Or what happened last year keep you from looking forward to something and weighing you down, you know, keeping you like half into the new year with hope, you know. You can just say, okay, that was a year that I can put behind me, and all the stuff that was there were some nice things. I appreciate some of the great things, but those not so great things, I don't have to think about them anymore. Put them completely behind me and move forward. And so thanks, Mike, for encouraging us with that. And I think that we can all use that encouragement, can't we?
Mm. Yes.
Yeah. You know, the Bible says confess your sins one to another. You know? So I was at Walmart the other day, and they told me that I wanted to bring back a defective LP tank, you know? And so every time I turned it, the gas would shoot upwards, so I knew that was a bad thing. So I called them and I said, well, what do I do with this? And they said, well, just take it back to any of the dealers, you know, and they'll take it back and exchange it. So I walk into the store with this thing, and it's like I was wearing a bomb vest. Everyone came after me and said, you have to leave. You have to leave the store now. I'm like, I just need to talk to the manager. You need to leave the store before you can talk to the manager. I was like, fine. I could have had a choice before me. I was either going to walk out and say nothing, and that way I wouldn't tarnish my Christian reputation. Or I was going to go back out and have bad attitude. Sure enough, went back out and had a terrible attitude going forward because I didn't really appreciate the situation. Then I had to wait a lot longer, like in the whole line again, you know, just to take care of business. So I'd like to put that behind me. How about you? Anything else you'd like to put behind you? Yeah, it's not a big thing, but it's one of those things where, you know, if that person showed up to church today, I'd be like, I'd be embarrassed. And that's just one of those. You ever have one of those days where you act so embarrassing, you know, you hope you'll never meet that person again? That'd be awesome if I never see you again. I'll pray for you in heaven, but don't look to me to be that person. I just blew it. That's all right. Actually, I have a saying that that applies here, and that is that most people get more influenced by you making the wrong thing right than they do having done the right thing all along. And that's so true. You know, when somebody comes back and says, you know, I was a real rear end about that, and I'm so sorry, you know. And they really appreciate that much more than if you were just came in with your attitude, pious attitude, and actually succeeded in being a good Christian that day. But so maybe I'll get a second chance. But anyway, I saw this. This is my unique opportunity to have read you this because it's the end of one year, the beginning of the next, and you know, Santa Claus and all that stuff just finished being a part of our year. So. Two boys were walking home from church one day after hearing a strong message about the devil. Now, I thought that was interesting because we'll be looking at that as we go through the book of Mark here. And one said to the other, what do you think about all that devil stuff? And the other boy said, well, you know how they told you about Santa Claus, right? You know how that turned out. It's probably your dad, the devil. So anyway, I thought that was interesting because we just finished with Santa. How many are glad to be finished with Santa? I am so glad that that's behind me. I don't want to see the red guy again until next year. Mm. I don't mean the devil, I mean Santa.
Yeah.
Mm. All right, let's go into the fourth chapter of Mark. And I'm sorry, third chapter of Mark. And pick it up there at the beginning of the book. A quick prayer of thanks for God's help this morning. Thank you, Father God, for your Holy Spirit helping us to both helping me to convey some of the things in your word you want us to know, but more so helping us as hearers to be able to discern what the Spirit is saying to us, your church, today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. How many know sometimes I was talking to Mary about the fact that Jesus appeared to many of his disciples after his resurrection. They were oblivious to who it was. You know, and we don't know the exact reasons behind that or something, but it is amazing to me that the Word can be standing in front of you and depending on you, the hearer, whether or not you receive from it. Isn't that what Jesus is? He's the Word, right? Mm-hmm. And he was standing right there in front of him, but it was depending on them whether or not they were able to discern it and to receive. And so I thought that was just interesting, that Jesus himself could stand before folks, and yet the hearts and eyes not be open to it. So we need the Holy Spirit to open our hearts and minds as hearers, not just as me to be a part of speaking the word, but for us as hearers to have the Holy Spirit working with us in unveiling, revealing the word to us. Amen?
Amen.
So that's why I pray, not just for me, I pray for us that we might hear what the Spirit is saying to the church today. All right, let's look at the third chapter of John.
Mark.
I'm sorry, Mark. And we'll start the first verse. And he entered in the synagogue again. And if you remember a little bit of where we came from, or you're just familiar with the book of Mark, there's been some talk about the Sabbath up to this point. And my favorite saying of that entire chapter was in verse 27. It says, "The Sabbath was made for man and not man for the Sabbath." I like that. It's kind of like the tail wagging the dog. You know, you want to get it. At one point, they got the tail wagging the dog, and then, you know, you got to realize, no, the Sabbath is here to help you to withdraw from your life and pace for a moment well enough to reconnect with God and get your own self ministered to. So, in the first verse in chapter 3, it says, "And he entered into the synagogue again, and a man there was there with a withered hand." And I kind of titled this chapter just briefly. It says, "God is such a rule breaker." And I like that because we do set up kind of arbitrary rules out there. And then we hold fast to them as though they were godliness, but really they're not. And so in this case, we see that there's a man there with a withered hand. And it really illustrates something about why God does what he does. And we talked about that. You are good. You know, God does what he does. Not just because we create the idyllic moment. It's not like a Hallmark moment in the kingdom of God and suddenly God can move, you know? He is just good. And he will move at whatever. I've told you this before about light, you know? You turn on this light in this little room over here and you'll see it come through a tiny little crack at the bottom of the door. I didn't make that crack so that the light could come through. It just is what it is. The light shines no matter what the smallest opportunity you give it. And that's how God is that he's good. He'll do the best he can with whatever you give him. Amen. It's not like you got to give him your best in order for him to do something. We try our best, but ultimately, it never is good enough. So the reality is that he just is good, and he'll do the best with whatever you give him. And if we could just kind of get that in our head, we'd stop getting critical of ourselves when we don't perform to a higher level, just because that's not going to help move the ball along. You know, being critical of yourself along the way isn't really going to help the ball move forward. So here, I like this. There's a guy with a withered hand in church, and he's in there. It says, and they watched him closely, talking about Pharisees, Sadducees. I say the Sadducees. I mean, it's not sure they're there, but the Pharisees are there, and the Herodians, which we'll get to in a minute, are there. And so here's this guy with a withered hand. And you would think that anytime somebody has a need, that others would be happy to see God in some way address, minister, or minister to that need. Not so in this case. It says, so they watched him closely whether he would heal him on the Sabbath. Remember, God's a rule breaker when it comes to the rules that just don't need to be there. They're things that we qualify, but God hasn't. And he says, okay. So they watched him closely to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath so they might accuse him. And he said to the man with the withered hand, step forward. And he said to him, is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do evil, to save life or to kill it? But they all kept silent. I think that says a lot, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. That says that their motives were pretty obvious. And this is one of the things that I like about Jesus during these things as we read through, is that we read in the other chapter where he was challenged. Now, I don't know about you, but how many fathers in here, you know, when your kids challenge you, did you react in love and in, you know, in just pure nothing more than just trying to have their best interest in mind? Most of the time when you were challenged, you were a little miffed, you know, and you end up kind of retaliating in some way. But Jesus doesn't do that. And that's a good lesson for love. You know, I want to learn from that. But it just amazes me that his own creation can challenge the Creator and he doesn't get miffed. You know, he's sad, as a matter of fact, that this happens. But it says here, he he told them to step forward, and he gives them an example. He doesn't berate them for their attempts to trap him into their rule breaking. He simply says to them, you know, on the Sabbath, isn't it right to do good rather than sin or do evil? And so they kept silent, and it says to him, and he looked around at them with anger, and he was grieved in their hardness of heart, and he said to the man, stretch out your hand. Now, I like this, because here it says he was angry with them for their hardness of heart. But even in the midst of being disappointed with the people that were in the crowd, he didn't let the man suffer for their hardness of heart. It's a beautiful thing to see that God just loves people in spite of people being unloving. And so here he says, he looked around about him, he said, stretch out your hand. And as he stretched it out, his hand was restored as whole as the other. In verse 6, and the Pharisees went out immediately and plotted with the Herodians against him how they might destroy him. Does that blow your mind or what? Just to think that you could have a miracle like that happen. Most of us would be very excited for that person. Yeah. We would be just very excited for ourselves to have been a part, to observe, to have seen it. But they were so hardened of heart, not only were they not happy to see a miracle in their midst, not only were they not happy to see the man's life forever changed, but they literally took that as a point of challenge to how, whether or not this man had the right to live any longer. Because he broke the Sabbath. God's a rule breaker. In those ways, can you say, thank God for it? Amen? How many of us wouldn't be here today if somebody didn't step over a boundary? If somebody didn't step out and share Jesus, or even pray for our healing, or pray for us, or set us free. I've had people who, I'm sure maybe you have too, you've had people who have had hands laid on, they've been delivered from demon forces, and then their life is forever changed. What good news, what great thing. But that's because somebody stepped out from a bunch of people who probably didn't feel comfortable doing that. They stepped over the line and they said, you know what, I'm gonna take a challenge here. I'm gonna step out in faith here, and I'm going to lay hands on that person, or I'm going to speak the word to them. I'm going to do something. Aren't you glad that somebody stepped out of the rules to touch you?
Yes.
Most of us are a testimony to somebody who stepped over a line and did something they wouldn't otherwise have done. They shared Christ with us in a tangible way instead of sitting there just keeping Jesus to themselves. Amen?
Amen.
For me, it was a prayer of a man that I didn't even know in a church where I'd only been once. But that man who prayed for me, laid hands on me and prayed, changed my life forever. When I went back to tell him, he didn't feel a thing. He had no cognitive understanding that anything had happened through him. But what God had done in me was life-changing. Sometimes you're not cognitive of the things that have been ministered to somebody through your simple act of obedience or just kindness. But it can forever change a life. I don't mean you have to walk around in some kind of a aura or a bubble of goodness and be that all the time in order for anything to happen. I'm just saying even when you don't think anything can happen, sometimes it still can. Amen. And that's a beautiful thing. It encourages us. Because sometimes we just don't feel like a great candidate for God's power. But you know what? It's not always how you feel. God loves that person more than requiring us to feel good about the situation in order for him to do something. That's good news. Amen.
Amen? Amen.
So the Pharisees decided that the enemy of my enemy is my friend. So you'll see that here. It says here that they plotted in verse 6, the Pharisees went out immediately and plotted with the Herodians against him and how they might destroy him. This is not conclusive of my initial study, just to give you a little insight on who those people are. Both are Jewish people, the Pharisees and the Herodians. Most of us are familiar with the Pharisees and not so much with the Herodians. Herodians would have been more of a political, they had more of a political slant to them because their name is obviously the name Herodians. Herod fits right in there because the Herods were placed there by the Romans to oversee the Jewish behaviors. But the Pharisees didn't want to be ruled over by anyone. So they were against the Herodians, because the Herodians were like, yeah, we'll do what Herod wants because this is good for us. But the Pharisees said, no, we don't like the Herodians. We don't like the Herods being over us. So they were enemies in that respect because they wanted their individuality. They wanted their own culture and their own religion to prevail. But when it came to their dislike for Jesus, they both shared the same dislike for him well enough to gain forces. So in that respect, I say that the enemy of my enemy is my friend. They made friends with one another to come against Jesus in this, at this point. And you'll see there's a lot more of this behavior going forward. All right, so in verse 7, but Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the sea, and a great multitude from Galilee followed him and into Judea. And some of this is a little long, so we're just going to read through it. It's just fact stuff. In Jerusalem, and I have to help me out here. Idumea? Okay. Idumea and beyond the Jordan, and those from Tyre and Sidon, and a great multitude, when they heard how many things that he was doing, came to him. So he told his disciples to get a small boat, and that they should be ready for him, because the multitude, lest they crush him. Now, I thought this was a beautiful thing because, again, it illustrates, you may not get much out of it until you think about it. You think about all these people, they've heard that Jesus is casting out devils and they've heard that he's healing the sick. So they are coming to him from all around, and it calls them a multitude. Not a multitude of happy, blessed folks. These are cranky. We talked about this before. These are cranky, uncomfortable people who need healing or deliverance. We're talking about the fruits and nuts category. We're talking about all kinds of, you know, people that have problems, both mental problems, physical problems. They're the kind of people you basically, you know, they're gonna be so uncomfortable in the quarters of one another that they're gonna make one another all uncomfortable. So it's kind of an ugly scene here in the fact that, yeah, God wants to help everybody, but again, these people are a danger to themselves. And literally, they're getting on too close to one another. And so he says, okay, what we're gonna do is we're gonna put me out on a boat, so we're gonna get a little distance between us, the people, and the whole situation here. We're gonna get a little distance so we can minister to them because we want everybody to be ministered to, but we want to do it in a way that helps everyone because I love everyone the same, says God. Amen?
Amen.
All right. He doesn't want the people who, like, can you imagine the blind guy? He wants to see. Well, you got the guy who can walk, but he can't talk. He's like, I'm gonna climb over the blind guy to get to Jesus first. I mean, this is literally a reality. People are coming from all around, and they're seeing people healed, seeing people whole. You know how it is when people want popcorn in line, much less how about when they want healing. I mean, people are desperate. So this is, you know, we got to put it back in context. These are desperate people with serious issues of life who see hope for getting help. So with that in mind, you can understand why Jesus doesn't want people hurting people in order to get to him. So he's trying to keep people from hurting one another. He's not trying to insulate himself. He's trying to insulate each other from one another. So he says, okay, let's get a boat, and we'll take care of this a little bit differently. And he says, verse 9, so he told his disciples to get a small boat and kept it ready, and that it should be kept ready for him because of the multitude, lest they should crush him. For he healed so many, and so many had afflictions, and pressed about him to touch him. And unclean spirits, whenever they saw him, fell down before him and cried out, saying, you are the Son of God. But he sternly warned them that they should not speak and make him known. Now, we've talked about this before. Whenever you have to deal with devils, and I hope that you realize this is a regular part of the spiritual dimension between good and evil, you are in the kingdom of God. You have an enemy who is always looking to diminish your effects of that kingdom. So the enemy is going to try and discourage or dissuade you. There are people that you will encounter that have demon influence in their life. And the first thing you should know is to tell them, stop talking or to shut up and come out. That is the only proper way, according to what we've seen up to this point in Jesus' ministry. We don't have conversations with the demon forces that are inhabiting people. We don't entertain them. We don't make a show of it. It is just simply shut up. In other words, no more talking. Nobody wants to hear from you. I don't want to hear from you, and nobody here is going to hear from you. And come out of him. That's the only way to handle those devils. No other thing is given to us through Scripture here. But it is interesting that, I'm going to get to that again a couple of verses down. So, but they sternly warned him not to speak. In verse 13, and he went up into the mountain. Well, I guess I can say it now. Here's when it comes to demons and demon forces, you have to remember that in the last chapter of Mark, Jesus was given to each and every one of us a dictate to cast out devils. You recall that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He said, believers. Everybody kind of raise one hand if you're a believer. Yeah. Okay. So, he's talking to who?
To me.
Me. That's right. He's talking to me in the last chapter of Mark. You want to slip over there, you can look at it. And he says, in my name, they shall cast out devils. So, say with me, in Jesus' name,
in Jesus' name,
I cast out devils.
I cast out devils.
That's great. Now, you don't have to say, I've had experience with it. You don't have to know when that will be. You just have to have your alignment with the Word of God. And as a believer, you may encounter and probably will at some point in life. And in His name, you cast them out. I had some lady at the Bible bookstore talk to me about it the other day. You know, it was a little unusual, but it happens. It's not as frequent as perhaps some people make it, and it's not as infrequent as other people make it. So your mileage may vary. The idea is that you're always a candidate with the name of Jesus and being a believer for casting out devils. All right. Let's see. So in verses 14 and 15, he appointed 12 that they might be with him and that he might send them out and preach to have power over healing, sicknesses, and casting out devils. Now, I'm going to read it just in the sake of time. I'll read it quickly as my eyes can see it. And Simon, to whom he gave the name Peter, and James, this is the apostles, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, the brother of James, whom he gave the name Boaginus, and sons of thunder. And in verse 18, it says, Andrew, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, the son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, whom betrayed him. And they went into a house. Now, I normally wouldn't even bother to read that because it was kind of one of those things that, you know, it is pretty much obvious. But then I got to thinking about it. I thought, especially in verse 19. Now, the other ones were interesting because it would say whom he gave the name Peter or something like that, or the sons of thunder. And you can all recall some of the stories in which those took place. But here in verse 19, this was amazing to me. He says, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him, and they went into the house. And so, I don't know about you, but we're talking about a God who is good and a God who loves everyone, regardless of their merits. And yet, among the 12, he chooses somebody that he up front knows will betray him. Now, I don't know about you, but most of the time when we invest in somebody, we want that to pay off. We feel like that's, you know, we want to put ourselves in the best candidates for a good outcome. And yet, he's got 12 among how many ever 100,000 there were on the earth at the time. He's got these 12, and one of them he knows right up front is going to betray him.
Yeah.
And yet he chooses him. That's phenomenal. It's phenomenal. Because in my understanding, it says, you know what? God looks at everyone with the same potential. He gives everyone the same love, same opportunity. Here's what I thought. Every day, Jesus didn't wake up for the approximately three years that he was in ministry on earth. I don't think he woke up every day pouring himself into a lemon and saying, you're an oddball. You are just one of those people. You're here. I know you were chosen, but I don't want anything to do with it. I think the same love, same compassion, the same respect, the same everything was given to every disciple, regardless of their merits, including Judas Iscariot, who would betray him. It's amazing to me to think that God looks at everyone. See, we're just tainted by the behaviors of either the past or the potential for a routine behavior. And so we look at people entirely differently. So I don't know how we can think that there's going to be a miraculous change if we can't look at people without the prejudices of their past or even knowing their future. And he knows their future, and yet he doesn't prejudice Judas by treating him any different. I would have excluded him myself. I would have said, you know what? You know, I got 12 people that are going to change the world, and you are a dud. So we're not moving forward with you. I mean, I think you'd have probably done the same thing. But doesn't it illustrate a God who looks at us not just for what potential we have, but gives everyone the same potential? He gives everyone the same opportunity, including people who will waste it. That's phenomenal. So you and I can't understand that. But a God who is love, not just has it, can't be any different towards one to another. So even though this guy is one of the duds, he treats him, incorporates him, brings him in the same, gives him the same love, so he has the same opportunity that everyone else has, even though God knows he won't take it from him. And isn't that the way salvation is? It isn't doled out just as you earn it or as you deserve it. It was already given, regardless of our deservedness. And I say now, thank God for it, because I never could have or would have deserved it. So I'm glad that God does that, regardless of whether we deserve it. Amen?
Amen.
So that's what that verse really speaks to me. All right, verses 20 through 21. When the multitude came there together again, so that they could not so much as eat bread, but when his own people heard about this, they went out and laid hold of him, and they said, he is out of his mind. And the scribes came down from Jerusalem and said, he has Beelzebub, and by the ruler of demons he casts out demons. So I thought this was interesting. First, his own people come to him and say, well, you know what, he's not eating, he's obviously not resting, so we're going to have to take things over because he's doing too much for too many, and he's not able to use good judgment at this point. And so that, and then the scribes come over and they start saying, well, he's full of Beelzebub. He only casts out devils by the prince of devils. Now, here's an interesting thing. In verse 23, and he called them to himself, and he said to them in parables, how can Satan cast out Satan? And I thought this was so interesting. Again, this is Jesus being so patient and so kind. I don't know. Have you ever, you raised your kids, right?
Yeah.
Or you know somebody who has. And when your kid said, you're out of your mind, did you take that well? I don't remember taking it very well. And then if they had told me something like, I was associated with the devil, that would have made me feel really irate. I would have been pretty upset. Here's Jesus, says he spoke to them in parables. I wouldn't have spoke to him in parables. I would have told him where to go right then. You don't even have to read between the lines. There's no parables here. But not Jesus. It amazes me because I realize just how far I have yet to go when somebody can say something to me that can so easily turn me into a defensive posture. But Jesus, do you see a defensive posture here? I mean, the guy has just been told he's nuts and he's only doing things by the prince of of the devils. I would have been defensive. No. It says, then he spoke to them in parables. In other words, I see you're not getting this, so let's look at it a different way. Does that blow your mind that God just, does it tell you something about how he loves you personally?
Yes.
When you're being stubborn, thick-headed, and you're not getting it, do you think God's sitting there, well, you know what? I have had enough of you. You remember that from the Star Trek movie where finally Khan is kicked off the edge of the cliff? Where, it's been his lifetime, Kirk's lifetime has been against this this arch enemy. And finally, you know, he's always saving him, and he's always doing, you know, if his life's in danger, instead of putting him in the, you know, in the death chair, he puts him in, you know, some kind of prison that he escapes from and comes back, and he does it all over again. Finally, one day he says, you know, there's this lava pit, and he's hanging over the edge, and finally he kicks his hands off the edge and says, "I have had enough of you," and off he goes.
Okay.
So anyway, you would think that someday God's just tired of dealing with us, you know? But the good news is that he doesn't get tired. He can't. I don't know how he does it, but he can't get so tired of trying to teach you that he runs out of resources and angles in order to try and teach us. Amen?
Amen.
We run out of resources and angles. We're like out of parables. We're completely out of ways to try and help you get this through. But he doesn't. So take heart. Even when you don't understand what he's doing, or you got irritations and all kinds of things that you it's not coming together for you and everything. Don't think that God has stopped to try and bring a new angle, a fresh insight into how to bring you further along in your walk with him. Amen? That's always good news. So, let's see, where are we? Here's kind of where we're gonna end it in 27. So we're just gonna leave you with this thought. He says, "How can Satan cast out Satan?" In other words, he goes on to explain, if a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom can't stand. And if a house is divided itself, the house cannot stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand and has an end. No one can enter into a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds a strong man, and then he will plunder his house. So we're going to kind of stop at verse 26 and think about verse 27 going forward and talk about more of that, about that later. But his idea is that he starts to talk about a parable to try and teach them, listen, it doesn't make sense that I'm under the influence of Satan, and yet I'm bringing Satan's influence to a lower, you know, I'm diminishing Satan's influence. This doesn't even make sense. And so I like the way he doesn't argue. He's not frustrated. Most of us would have called down thunder like the sons of thunder, you know, and said, "How dare you question the Son of God?" You know, that kind of thing. But here he is, just really having your best interest at heart. And that's one of the beautiful things, is that God's always looking to bring us along in love. Amen? He gives us parables, illustrations, instead of retaliations. And he answers his critics in love. Let's just believe God right now in Jesus' name for him to do something in our hearts that would illustrate some of the, not just patience and kindness, those things are awesome, but, you know, just our own insecurities. Really, I think that's more about where we need to be, is God help us with our own insecurities, because we tend to so easily be offended, so easily be challenged. Our authority is so immature that, in other words, we have not grown in the authority of who we are, that it's when it's challenged, we become unhinged. And so my prayer is that God would just help us to be under his authority and therefore in authority, and not be so just easily swayed, intimidated by whether it's other believers or who don't understand where we're coming from, or whether it's the world that doesn't see it like we do. Father God, by your Spirit, I pray that we would just become all the more sure in your authority. You chose 12, and one of them wasn't even worth choosing in our opinion. But God, how about us here today? We're more than 12. You've chosen us. And God, we didn't deserve your choosing, but you've chosen us in the And most of us would say, we're not near as bad as Judas. We're not going to turn back on you and turn you in. But God, regardless, you've chosen us. And if we had known about ourselves what you knew about us, we probably wouldn't have even chose ourselves. But God, you've done that, because you give everyone the same love, same respect, same all care. And so God, with that same love and same care, God, I put behind me everything that says I don't deserve it, or every action that illustrates I don't deserve it. And I right now thank you, God, that you have authorized me to be a member of your kingdom. And in spite of myself and my past, I'm going to look forward that I am an authorized member of your kingdom, authorized to share your word, preach your word, to share it in whatever way you make possible, and to handle the enemy in every way he tries to diminish it. In Jesus' name, amen. So, now as a statement of faith, are you ready?
Yes.
Because I stand. In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
I am not easily intimidated.
I
stand my ground
on the word of God.
And on my faith.
In
Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm going to walk out of here a lot better than when I came.
Amen.
I'm not touchy, easily intimidated. I know when I walk out of here, you know, it's not about me. It's about what God wants to do in the person on the other side of the gospel. Amen.
Amen.
All right, let's receive this morning's tithes and offerings real quick. And Catherine, you're always good to help us out with that. And if you would pronounce God's blessing on not only the offering, but every gift and every giver.
Father, we just praise you and thank you for your love and mercy and grace, and thank you for your provision, and we just pray that you bless every gift and we'll reap souls into your kingdom and bless every giver. In Jesus' name, amen.
And when you get a chance, pat Mary on the back, tell her how much you appreciate her doing.